and you heard about me.
Ooh, that's some big enemies. But so sorry that it's been quite a number of weeks since our last Midnight's Breakdown. Everybody's doing everything at the moment. We've got Taylor, we've got Miley, we've got Lana, we've got Gracie. Like, people are releasing things at the moment. And here we are, back with another Midnight's Breakdown.
I'm
and
really
today
excited.
We are doing Labyrinth.
Oh, lovely little Labyrinth. She gets neglected, I feel. She gets overlooked, and we're here to remind you of why
you should not,
be doing that because it is a very offensive and superior song, especially Jack Antonoff and his production. The things that are happening towards the outro of this song.
No, the outro is everything. And this is actually quite an interesting song on that note, is that there's actually not a lot of lyrics and there's not a lot of like information, if that makes sense, because so much of it is just the outro where she's repeating those lyrics that we've already had earlier in the song. And I really love that these sorts of songs are part of her discography because it does break it up a bit from what we're so used to with like perfect lyricism and storytelling. And even though this song is still perfect lyrically, it's just got a very different energy to, you know, with the bridges and the outros and the three verses and the pre-choruses. Like, there's not as much of it.
This song has less lyrics, but I feel like the lyrics she does say really hit hard.
Yes.
And I think that they create an atmosphere to kind of almost feel a certain feeling. And I think the music really takes you there in this one. And the kind of the ambience of the song really supports that.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, it is it's a really nice break in the album, I feel, and just like very much like needed to kind of give you a bit of breathing space, and I really appreciate this song, especially just in the car at nighttime.
It's such a good driving
in your room
song
at nighttime. Like, it's such a nighttime song in my mind, and it's just there's something about it that you really need to be in the song. I don't feel like I can be doing anything else while listening to Labyrinth.
No, and you know, I think that makes a lot of sense because obviously the song is called Labyrinth because she says lost in the labyrinth of my mind. So the labyrinth is like the maze of being so caught up in overthinking and overanalyzing everything and just being stuck in your head. And so it makes a lot of sense for this song to kind of allow you the space to kind of be in that. And I think that's why that outro is there and why there is less in terms of, you know, the verses and the chorus and why the words and the lyrics are repeated in that outro.
I agree.
It's kind of got a similar effect as saying, "Are we out of the woods?" consistently in that chorus. It's meant to be a spiral or like representative of that anxiety.
I'm so excited to get to that. And I think that we should really just get into it and have a
Let's
bit of a
listen.
Let's get
into it. Absolutely. Oh, that too. Do we believe that that's vocals there?
I definitely think that is, but you know, that first sound that we hear, it is extremely interesting.
It's hard to tell.
I think it might be a vocal. Jack really flexes his interesting sounds in this song.
That's actually so true.
Reminds me a little bit of Melodrama and some of the songs on that album, like Hard Feelings. That's what I love about this song is it's quite unique and there's a lot of different sounds coming in that make it interesting.
So true. It doesn't say anything about backing vocalists in the credits.
Yeah,
so
it's not really a backing vocal, is it? It's like a voice that's been turned into an instrument.
Which I guess is a common theme on Midnight's as well, like sort of doing that voice effect. It almost makes it sound sometimes like it's not a voice and it could just be an instrument.
Absolutely. And that's something we've been touching on with the Midnight Breakdowns, the vocal effects that happen on this album that make it so different and are extremely present on songs like Midnight Rain. But Labyrinth also definitely falls into that, especially as we get more into the song.
Yes.
But right up here we have some vocal effects happening that are almost just disguised as instruments.
Yeah.
And I love it.
It's really, really great, isn't it?
It only hurts this much right now was what I was thinking the whole time. Breathe in, breathe through. I'll be getting over you, my heart.
There's so much to say. I think what's so interesting about this song and how it's been analyzed by fans since it came out is that it feels like there is potentially a double meaning throughout this song, and one of them is linking back to themes that are explored later in The Great War or in Afterglow, or just even things like explored in Cornelia Street, like this concept of Taylor wanting to break up with Joe and maybe thinking that the relationship's not going to go anywhere before it all turns around and it does go somewhere.
Yeah.
But also it seems that a lot of people have been interpreting it as though it could be a reflection of that time when she wasn't seen for a year and the reputation kind of era and really struggling through the emotions of that time.
Yes.
And it's really interesting how a lot of these lyrics can sort of fit both of those scenarios.
It's interesting that you're saying both of those scenarios, because I think that they're kind of the same scenario in my head.
Well, that's true. I guess it all kind of happened at the same time, didn't it? Because that year that she wasn't seen is also the year that she fell in love with Joe.
I think also sonically this song is so interesting because there is that deepness in the beat and kind of the repetition of that beat kind of occurring, which kind of does hint this kind of anxiety feeling, also a spiraling kind of feeling.
It almost sounds like a fast heartbeat. It's like boom, boom.
But then she's singing in a really high-pitched, breathy voice, which I've always found interesting about this song as well, that we kind of go there in the verses and she really stays up there because it does almost feel like it's a bit mystical, this song as well.
You're so right. Yes, it kind of feels very light and airy, even though there is also that anxiety of an undercurrent in it. And also the lyrics aren't light and airy. You know, what she's talking about is quite heavy, quite emotional. But you do sort of have that space for it to sort of feel like you're sort of up
here. It only hurts this much right now was what I was thinking the whole time. I think what we've kind of thought that she's talking about here is just those first kind of thoughts after she's decided to try and end things in a relationship, and particularly with Joe. I think everyone can relate to that feeling.
Absolutely.
It's only going to hurt this much right now. You know, I just have to get through this pain of the initial kind of separation, breakup decision.
Absolutely.
And to follow it with breathe in, breathe through, breathe deep, breathe out. I'll be getting over you my whole life. I really love as well, because I think she's really told us that emotion there straight away, but then how she's kind of coping with that feeling, which is through breathing and kind of trying to feel it, trying to process it.
Yes. What I love about it is that it's not actually exploring necessarily what the issue is.
Mm-hmm.
It's exploring her own internal processing of trying to convince herself that she will move on and that she will get over it.
Yep.
And it's like her, I mean, it makes so much sense. Labyrinth. It is the maze of her mind,
exactly.
Right? And this verse perfectly represents her being in her head trying to tell herself and trying to take action into feeling better. She's telling herself it only hurts this much right now.
Mm.
She's telling herself to breathe in, breathe through, breathe deep, breathe out. Like, she's actively trying to control her breath and calm herself down because she's actually panicking.
She's panicking.
She's actually overthinking.
Yeah.
And that's where that boom, 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 boom. That anxious heartbeat
like
sounding.
Reminder.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's a reminder of, I mean, it actually is just perfectly detailing her inner world. It's her inner thoughts and it's her inner feeling.
Yeah, you're right.
You are in this
labyrinth.
This labyrinth
mind.
With her.
Yeah.
You're in this labyrinth with her. And that is such a testament to, that is such a testament to Jack.
Ugh,
the fact that he is able to match what Taylor is saying lyrically so perfectly in his production. I mean, it's one thing for her to say what she's saying here, and that can translate on a piano or a guitar. But to add the production that actually emphasizes the panic
feeling
of what she's feeling, to contrast that with her trying to calm herself down lyrically, is really quite incredible.
Oh my God, you're so right. You've just said everything right there. Oh my God, it's actually an amazing
song. It's actually crazy.
Yeah, of course it is, but like,
Something that I just want to touch on as well, I think it's so important that she ends that verse with "I'll be getting over you my whole life," because I think it really brings us back to it being this same story of, you know, maybe things possibly ending with Joe before they even really got started. And the fact that we just have so many songs of her exploring right from the beginning, how she felt like he was the one almost instantly, like king of my heart. We met a few weeks ago and you're already the king of my heart.
Yes.
You know, like it's, I think it's really bringing it back to the fact that like, I've immediately felt like you are the one.
Yeah.
And I will be getting over you my whole life now that I know that we're not going to be together, or now that I think we're not going to
because
be together.
She put up walls because she felt like there was no point in exploring it because her life and her world would destroy the relationship and that he wouldn't survive it. Like she says in Dancing With Our Hands Tied, I thought there was no one in the world that could take it. Or in Cornelia Street when she says, you know, I thought you were leading me on. I thought it was never really going to go anywhere. And I think that that's this song. It does connect all those songs so beautifully and fill us in on a little bit more of her thought process and how she was feeling at the time.
You know how scared I am of it.
Melody, I don't know, something about it makes me feel like we are actually in an elevator.
You're so
like,
right.
You know how scared I am of elevators.
You're right. Like even the way she's singing it is actually consistently elevating.
Yes.
So I have so much to say
about please, this pre-chorus. Please take us away.
So not only do I think that this is just like a perfect metaphor for I get scared when relationships go too quickly.
Yes. Yeah.
I get scared that they're not going to last, you know, like the quicker you dive into something, the more likely it is that you're not really seeing it for what it is. And maybe you've got rose colored glasses on. You're in that lavender haze, if you will.
Never trust if it rises fast, you know, like if you have too many good feelings too quickly, that is something that she doesn't trust.
Exactly. So to use that as a metaphor, like an elevator rising too fast is really perfect.
I agree. The elevator metaphor is perfect. And it does also make me think of the Bejeweled music video again a little bit with the whole kind of music video being centered around the elevator and her re-records, but also maybe moving on with Joe and being still Bejeweled and all of that kind of stuff. So I do think that is interesting.
I'm falling in love.
And space after
the, it really gives you some breathing room.
And this, what on earth is that sound?
What is that sound?
God knows, but I fucking love it.
Yeah.
This chorus is superior because I really do feel like she's going through different stages of emotions with these lyrics here. First of all, it's uh-oh, I'm falling in love, and it really feels like, I'm scared, like, uh-oh, this is happening. Especially after, you know, exploring the fact that she, you know, thought that maybe it wasn't going to work out, she doesn't trust the elevator, and now we're coming to this chorus of being like, uh-oh, I'm falling in love.
Yes.
Oh, no, I'm falling in love again. So I think that again is really also telling of the fact that there's a reason she has these fears is because of these past relationships that haven't worked out. And I guess the media ruining them and all sorts of so much that comes along with that for her.
Absolutely. I also think that it being, oh no, I'm falling in love again. For some reason in my mind, it even links back into King of My Heart where she says, I've made up my mind. I'm better off being alone. It really is telling of where she was at with her relationship history at this point in her life. And the fact that sort of moving into this experience with Joe, was really determined to not do that. And so to realize that she's falling in love here, it's like, oh no, like I decided that this is not good for me.
Not good.
I can't let this happen again.
Yeah.
Like I'm falling in love again.
Yeah. But then the third one is a, oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
oh, I'm falling in love. Maybe this isn't so bad.
Maybe I can do it.
Which is why it's perfectly followed by those next lines.
I thought the plane was going down. How'd you turn it right around?
Mm-hmm.
She's like, I thought we were doomed. That's why it's oh no. That's why it's uh-oh. How did you turn it right around? And yeah. I think that really is, that lyric is so simple, but it really does sum up, I guess, what happened there with Joe.
Absolutely. I think that even though they're such simple lyrics, there's a lot that it holds for me.
Mm.
I think that the how'd you turn it right around is so interesting because it's also the car that she turns around in Cornelia Street when she realizes that he's saying no. So that's a car, this is a plane, but either way, everything's being turned back around.
Yes.
I think it really emphasizes the difference in a relationship dynamic that Joe was actually able to offer her, something that she'd never experienced before and wasn't expecting, and the fact that he was actually able to meet her there emotionally and demand that this doesn't happen, that this is not the end. And that's probably something that she wasn't expecting because, yeah, she hadn't experienced that before. Someone who was actually determined to fight for her despite all of the reasons that she can see in her mind, as you said, in sort of explored in Dancing with Our Hands Tied, why no one should really want to be with her or why no one would work. But I also wonder as well if it's a little bit of a link back into Snow on the Beach where she says, my flight was awful, thanks for asking. You know, like in here, she's like, the plane was going down, but actually you turned it back around. Like those beginning parts of the relationship before she fully lets herself immerse and bask in the love that's explored in Snow on the Beach. Actually, the flight was awful until you turned it around. And now it's like snow at the beach.
Yes, I love that connection. If that is purposeful or not, I don't know. But I do love thinking about it in that way. And I also think it's interesting that we do have a lot of rising kind of themes in this song, like with the rising elevator being up high. And I think also the plane, like kind of symbolizing that when you're up high, there is somewhere to fall, there is somewhere to go.
I think that connects so perfectly with those first few lines of how she's repeating that she's falling in love again, because she's actually emphasizing falling in love as almost like a negative thing. And so the plane falling down, going down,
but he's
like if you're falling
around
in a plane. But because he's yes. There's actually a lot here.
I just really love that kind of strip back and that simplicity of her repeating, but the subtle differences in each line and the meaning that those differences hold, I think is really special and can be so overlooked in this song. It only feels this wrong right now. Oh my God, it's actually really quite offensive, this whole verse, but how she uses break in so many different ways. Oh my God, we'll get to that. But before that, it only feels this raw right now, lost in the labyrinth of my mind. So she's really tapping back into that first verse there where she said it only hurts this much, you know, now, and now it's only feels this raw. So it's kind of like she's trying to, once again, trying to convince herself that this pain is just going to be here for now. Mm. Then that lost in the labyrinth of my mind really is the center of this song. And the meaning of the song. This is her thought process. This is her trying to figure out that thought process and how she feels. And her mind is like a labyrinth. I love that comparison because sometimes it really does feel like that. Like there's no way out. It's a maze.
Yeah.
It feels like you're trapped in those thoughts. Yeah. It feels like you're spiraling. There's no end in sight. There is no exit in sight. And I think that is a amazing metaphor for how it feels sometimes with anxiety.
It's so funny to think back to when she was announcing the track titles for this album on TikTok, because Labyrinth really threw me and I was like, I can't even begin to imagine what a song called Labyrinth could be about. But the second that I fathomed that this was about her overthinking, I was like,
perfect.
I've never heard of a more perfect thing
no
to phrase,
yeah,
what that feels like. Your like mind is like a labyrinth. Like, what?
Whenever Taylor Swift has a really rogue, like, title of a song that you just can't imagine, it always ends up being the most offensive metaphor for something.
Yeah, right?
And you're like, oh my God, of course.
So true. Break up, break free, break through, break down. You know, what I find interesting with this, when you compare it to the previous verse with the breathe in, breathe through, breathe deep, breathe out, is there something about the breathing that's trying to make this all calmer and like it's going to improve the situation? But in this one, with her ending with break down, it's actually continuing this negative cycle, this negative thought pattern. Like, nothing's actually improving. Like, no. We break up. I've broken free, I've broken through, but now I'm breaking down.
Absolutely.
Like, it actually kind of ends on a more negative note compared to the breathing one.
Yeah, it feels like she's trying to process, but it's not actually getting anywhere. And I think the break instead of the breathe definitely does feel like it's a bit more, like, intense, and that this is kind of the hardest part of the song that she's really struggling with. And I think that's why it comes after the Labyrinth lyric as well,
because yeah,
she's like in the thick of it. But the fact that she uses break in so many different ways, because then we have "you would break your back for me to break a smile," like, I just think that is so genius. The fact that she's saying that she's kind of breaking all these different ways that she's breaking, but he would break his back
to make
for her
smile.
To break a smile.
Yeah.
Like, that's what he wants. He wants her to break a smile, even though she's breaking in all these other ways. And he would break his back to make that happen. I think that proves how he turned it around.
Absolutely.
How and why they've made it through.
Given that we know from this song and other songs that she really did go through a moment of spiraling and feeling like there was going to be this breakup.
Yeah.
When he did come to her with this conversation of like, no, this is not what's happening here, I'm sure that there would have been some sort of a digging her out of this hole that she's buried herself in her mind, which is what this is.
Yeah.
And so I think that it makes so much sense that, like, even as she's processing the fact that she's thinking she's about to go through this breakup, he's actually there trying to make things better, trying to convince her and reassure her that she's got nothing to worry about.
Yeah.
That he can actually pull her out of this pit of despair.
That could even be the process of him doing that, like, break up, like, maybe in her mind she's, you know, they're breaking up, but maybe then the break free of is breaking free out of that labyrinth, breaking free out of her mindset around that breakthrough, like, she's realizing. And then the breakdown could even be like the aftermath of actually coming out of that and having a bit of a, like, a realization of how, where her own mind takes her in a way.
Yes, and almost like a breakdown can happen when you're actually in that moment of relief.
Yeah,
like, when you finally feel the relief that that's not happening. You can just kind of collapse into your emotions because you're like, oh my God, the relief that I feel that it's not happening.
Absolutely.
That's when the breakdown really, like, this is, especially in that first verse, she's really trying to hold herself together. But you're right, maybe in him actually repairing this situation and trying to pull her out of where her head's at, be like, it's okay, this is not happening right now.
And then she breaks down. Then she breaks down almost because it could have been the break up would have been the start of that conversation, and it's gone through a break free, a breakthrough, and then a breakdown of her kind of actually being vulnerable to him.
Yes.
And actually sharing that. And then he would break, because following it with "you would break your back for me to break a smile" makes me feel like that they could be connected. Like that's a process that she went through with him almost.
I think you're right. Think you're right. Absolutely.
Really interesting lyrics.
Yeah.
I really love that verse. You know how much I hate that everybody just expects me to bounce back, just like that. Oh, I'm falling in love. That drop into the chorus is just too heavenly.
It's quite
can't.
Heavenly is a good word for it.
And this pre-chorus changes, obviously, to really give us extra insight into how vulnerable she is feeling. And it actually makes a lot of sense that that's coming after that verse, because the first pre-chorus is talking about how she doesn't trust, you know, she has that wall up. She's not actually letting him in after breathing through her feelings and whatnot. But after she's having this breakdown and this breakthrough and realizing that he just wants to help her, she's like, you know how much I hate that everyone just expects me to bounce back. It's like she's sharing that with him there and almost in this vulnerable way letting him in into that labyrinth of her mind.
Yeah. You know, I also think that it is maybe important to also touch on like what it is that she feels like she's bouncing back from in that moment. Mm. When I think about what it is that she's touching on there, I find it interesting because it almost feels like a regression back into the feeling of like, I'm now about to go through this breakup that's going to literally break me. Like, this is going to be so hard. Mm. And I feel like the feeling of being expected to bounce back is even explored in something like Right Where You Left Me. Mm. Like, breakups happen every day. You don't have to lose it. Like, get on with it. Yeah, people are expecting her to just move on from these relationships so quickly.
I think that I have a bit of a different way of looking at this, and only now am I realizing it as we're breaking it down because of what I just said about that verse. And the fact that she's saying, you know how much. I feel like that is a moment of her talking to Joe there. And I feel like, given the timing of this all happening, I feel like she's letting him in that moment in her inner world of how she's feeling about the reputation error and about the Kanye situation and about how she's scared right now and she feels paralyzed by what her next move is and how to come back from it. So I agree with everything that you just said, but I think in the context of this song and at this point in the song, it almost makes more sense to me that she's talking, she's almost letting him, she's leaning on him in this moment of where she's at in her life with bouncing back in terms of her career and from that situation.
Well, and this is what I was touching on at the beginning of the video with people exploring that this song could also be about that whole period of time when she wasn't seen for a year, but not actually necessarily in relation to her relationship with Joe. Mm. And that's exactly where that sort of comes into it in this pre-chorus, like bouncing back from the hate, bouncing back from the entire internet tearing her down.
That is both. And I think that is inevitable because I think that those two things happened at the same time.
They are connected.
They're connected.
Yeah.
Her getting with Joe and her coming back from the Kanye situation is intertwined. So it makes sense for the song to explore both of those kind of avenues in a way.
Well, that's what the entire Reputation album is it not?
Yeah.
She's like, my reputation's never been worse. So you must like me for me. Mm. She's constantly battling on Reputation between everybody hates me and is expecting me to bounce back, but like I can't do that because I'm seriously damaged.
Yeah.
But I'm also falling in love with you and I'm scared about that because you should hate me because the whole world hates me right now.
My reputation's never been worse. And I think that song is capturing both the fear around falling in love is not just about having her heart broken again. It's about opening her heart to someone whilst she's going through one of the biggest things in her life.
Absolutely. If everything else was okay in her personal life and in her career at that point, she probably wouldn't have as many reservations about entering a new relationship and falling in love.
Totally.
But because the whole world hates her, she's even more scared about how this person's going to perceive her.
Right. It's so hard to have that vulnerability that you need to have at the beginning of a relationship when you're so wounded and scared of what's happening to you in the world right now. It's so hard to open up your heart to someone. That's why it's scary that she's falling in love.
Absolutely. And we know from so many lyrics and even things that she said that this was arguably the worst period that she's ever been through in her life. So to fall in love with the love of her life at the same time, again, it just makes so much sense that she'd be grappling with so many different feelings and so much fear during that whole process.
Oh, I think that we just fathomed a lot.
I think that we did, absolutely. And I really like your interpretation of that pre-chorus being like she's actually finally leaning on him. And you know, that might even make sense with the then going into the outro being
like a
lighter burst. And like a release almost, because she's actually able to let go of those reservations and lean into the relationship. And then all of a sudden everything feels lighter.
It's so is that, I think. I think that this song is giving us that release that we kind of wanted with the Archer, but I think that that served a different purpose. This song actually does give us that release of energy and anxiety. It's like all of her issues actually do dissolve with the release of the production at the end of this song. And I think that this song really does just capture the fear and anxiety around opening yourself up to someone again and being stuck in your head about it. And that's why I think it is just such a beautiful, beautiful, relatable, vulnerable song.
You really fucked me up with that connection to the Archer, because you're so right. The Archer holds that same feeling of anxiety, but continues to hold the feeling of anxiety, whereas this allows it to be released.
Well, which is why it's actually important that the Archer does that, especially because she's talking about the negative cycle of her anxiety and her anxious attachment style, especially by repeating the first verse again by saying, combat, I'm ready for combat. Of course we didn't have a release.
Oh, yeah.
She's starting again. There's not meant to be a solution in that
and
song.
there's no growth in that song in terms of I want to move past this part of me that feels the need to lash out, to be reactive, like I'm ready to fight at all times.
I think that the Archer really does it. The Archer is just perfect. The Archer's fucked up in its own way, but I am glad that this one does give us that progression and that release. And oh my god, it's so
The outro of this song is the highlight.
I thought the plane was going down. How'd you turn it right around? I'm falling in love. I'm falling in love again. I'm falling in love. I thought the plane was going down. How'd you turn it all around? I'm falling in love.
So sorry, I know that there's more, but I have so many things I need to say.
I understand.
I need to say so many things. Not only does that lightness feel like you're flying, like you're feeling the plane having turned back around, the drum beat also changes so it doesn't feel so much like a heartbeat of anxiety. It just feels like a drum beat that's meant to be in a song.
Yes. It feels like almost we're like entering zero gravity or something.
Yes,
like
absolutely. You're just floating now. It feels
like
we become
like almost just...
You're on the plane that's turned around. It's safe now.
It's safe now. There's no turbulence. It just like when you're on the plane and it's just, you're just in the air. You don't even understand how you're there. Like that's what that drop kind of feels like.
Absolutely. It's also her backing vocals being in a higher register. They're lighter, but she's no longer doing the no. Or she's going, I'm falling in love. I'm falling in love again.
Totally.
She's actually like the lightness and the fact that she's only saying that she's falling in love rather than like preceding it with the Like obviously that lyric's still there, but she is doing, I'm falling in love. Yeah, I'm falling in love again.
They're separating that by doing the vocal effect on the So the uh-ohs turn into that different... It almost takes it away from being Taylor.
Yes.
And because they got the vocal effect on it. And then she's singing
the part that you recognize as her voice feels like a celebration the fact that she's falling in love now. Oh my God, rather than it being a fear that she's falling in love.
Totally. You're so right.
So all of these things come together to create that release and that lightness, that safety that she feels now that she knows that she doesn't have to worry about this relationship going anywhere.
You're so right. It's actually amazing. And then there's these little trickles of coming in with the production that is just adding this lightness and this glitteriness to it. But then the beat, the boom, boom, I also really love as well, because the pattern of that drum is quite unexpected. I think the first time I heard it, I didn't know where it was going. And now that I know it so well, I really love that contrast with the kind of ambience of the production, because I think that it's just an interesting sound. And my ear is like, oh, satisfied by it.
So satisfying. Good. It's so good.
Why? How? I don't understand.
No, this was some Jack Antonoff shit. What the Jack fuck is he doing here? No. I physically don't understand how you can make it so perfect.
Oh, no, I really don't understand. And then shall we continue? Because there is more. There is more.
I'm falling in love again. I'm falling in love. I thought the plane was going down.
moment with that now that I've also kind of talked about, because she's repeating that pre-chorus there, that you know how much I hate.
That's all she says, though.
Yeah, you know how much I hate. Saying, you know how much I hate.
It's actually saying, you know how much I hate.
Yes.
You know how much I hate. You know. And I love that, like, that's just such an interesting part of the song.
Well, this is what I've just been fathoming.
Okay, cool, please.
Because just in this moment there, obviously, as the song goes on, there's a little bit more layers happening. You know, the falling in love comes in and then the hate, you know, so there's layers. But because she's highlighting the falling in love in this more positive, celebratory way that you just said, that's made me think about the choice to repeat that particular pre-chorus in the outro, which I just said before, I feel like is the one time that she's leaning on him. She's opening up to him. So I feel like she's emphasizing in that outro, because she's falling in love again. She's telling him, you know how much I hate. Like, that conversation is kind of something that she's now discussing with him and letting him in on.
Oh my God, you're so right. Yes, absolutely.
I had not fathomed.
Yes. It's further emphasizing the fact that she can lean into this love now by repeating the phrase that she is saying to him.
You know how much I hate. She doesn't even need to continue the thing, because she's just emphasizing that she's saying that to him. You know how much I hate. Like, I'm having this moment with you because we're falling in love. And now we're ending in this beautiful celebration of our love, that our flight that is still flying strong, and I'm leaning on you.
You're so right.
I'm so concerned.
You know, it's also quite interesting as well when you think about the fact that what she's repeating is, like, you know, how much I hate that everyone just expects me to bounce back whilst she's bouncing back.
I agree.
Like, that part of the song being light, it is her bouncing back and finding that happiness and that lightness again and releasing herself from the labyrinth of her mind. Mm-hmm. And so for that... That nice bouncing contrast. Back to, yeah, yeah, to be contrasted with her repeating, like, you know how much I hate that everyone expects me to do this so fast.
But I will.
But I am doing
it.
I am doing it right now.
Totally. Oh my God. It's actually a lot. Guys.
Oh my God.
I'm having such a moment with this superior song.
I really just love breaking down these songs and having an individual video for each of them to really, like, dive deeper into them and explore them, because it is amazing how much, like, even we get so much from filming these videos because we don't pre-plan them. We just sit down and we fathom, and whatever comes out comes out.
Yes.
And that's so special for us to fathom as well as you guys.
Totally. Because we would be doing this off camera, but we just save it for camera now. And it is a really nice time to actually dedicate to appreciating these songs that we love so much.
So many people don't stop and think about that, and that's okay. But what I find amazing about it is that regardless of whether or not you're actually consciously thinking about it, you're feeling it regardless. Feeling it. Like, you're this song is taking you on the journey that we are discussing today, regardless of the fact that you're aware of it or not.
No, you're right.
And that's what's so amazing about Taylor and Jack working together. Taylor and how she progresses the story with her lyrics, and Jack, how he adds to the emotion of a song with his production.
He meets her there every fucking time, and that's why she takes songs like this to him, I feel.
Yeah.
Songs like this, songs like The Archer, songs like My Tears Ricochet. There's just something that he can do that honestly, I just...
No, Jack Antonoff is just truly offensive. He's an offensive man.
We love him.
I don't even understand.
Thank you, Jack. Thank you for this.
Thank you, Jack.
Wow, I thoroughly enjoyed that breakdown. I hope that you guys got as much from it as we did.
Oh, yeah.
And can appreciate...
Absolutely. Yeah. As always, please comment your thoughts and opinions down below. If there's anything that we didn't touch on that you think that we need to fathom, please leave your comments. Your fathomings help us fathom further as well.
Oh my God, all
so
the time.
It's a communal experience. We love to see it. Thank you so much for being here always, and we will see you very soon.
Bye. Bye.